Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Hindware Home Innovation Limited Q1 FY24 earnings call hosted by Monarch Networth Capital. This conference call may contain forward-looking statements about the company, which are based on the beliefs, opinions, and expectations of the company as on the date of this call. These statements are not the guarantees of future performance and involve risks and uncertainties that are difficult to predict. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference, please signal an operator by pressing star, then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Rahul Dani from Monarch Networth Capital. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Aman. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Monarch Networth Capital, we are delighted to host the senior management of Hindware Home Innovation. We have with us today Mr. Salil Kapoor, CEO, Hindware Home Innovation Limited, Mr. Sudhanshu Pokhriyal, CEO, Bath Division, Mr. Rajesh Pajanu, CEO, Pipe Division, Mr. Sandeep Sikha, Group CFO, and Mr. Naveen Malik, CFO, Hindware Home Innovation, and CDR, the Investor Relations Team. We will start the call with the opening remarks from the management, then we'll move to Q&A. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Hindware Home Innovation Limited Quarter 1 FY24 earning call. Kindly note that some of the remarks or observations made during today's call might be forward-looking, such as financial projections or statements regarding the company plans, objectives, expectations, or intentions. The company does not have any obligation to revise these forward-looking statements to reflect any future event or development. For a comprehensive disclaimer, please refer to slide number 2 of the results presentation. At the outset, I am pleased to introduce and welcome Mr. Salil Kapoor, CEO, Hindware Home Innovation Limited. Salil brings with him over 30 years of diverse experience, primarily in the consumer durable field. His sector expertise and insightful perspective will play a vital role in shaping our strategic objectives. In his earlier assignment, he has led Orient Electric Appliance Division and held leadership position at LG Electronics, Samsung, Voltas, among others. Salil will be representing consumer and retail business in this investor call. Now, let me briefly touch upon our performance for the quarter, post which the business CEOs will discuss the key highlights of their respective businesses. Our quarter-one performance was largely impacted by a challenging external environment resulting from increasing inflationary concerns impacting demand of consumer discretionary goods. Against this backdrop, the company registered revenue for the quarter, which stood at Rs. 634 crore. Despite lower top line though, our EBITDA and margin improved on a year-on-year basis to Rs. 68 crore and 10.7% respectively. This is primarily the result of a better product mix and operating efficiencies along with initiative towards optimizing working capital management in alignment with our provided guidance. Our focus in the near term is to identify and adopt business strategies that will help us navigate the inflationary challenges. We continue to make steady progress towards building a pipeline whose backbone is innovation and customer centricity. Our long-term endeavor is to introduce a range of smart, connected products that integrate innovation and aesthetics, enriching our customers' lives and living spaces. We remain confident about the prospect of our businesses and its ability to drive growth. I would like to call Mr. Sudhanshu Pokhriyal to talk you to the bath business. Over to you, Sudhanshu.
Thank you, Naveen. Good afternoon, everyone. In quarter 1 FY24, our revenues were flattish compared to the corresponding quarter last year. We delivered a revenue performance of 362 crores over last year quarter 1 of 364 crores. This is a degrowth of about minus 11% in QOQ terms, quarter on quarter terms, and is a CAGR, 4-year CAGR of 13% over quarter 1 of pre-COVID FY20. Our flat growth is largely because of a heavy base of last year quarter one, where we had taken an extremely high price increase considering the input price situation there at that time. So additionally, the market demand has also been muted in Q1. Albeit with a lag, increased input and land prices along with higher interest rates with significantly increased EMIs has impacted the demand in the building real space. This is also visible in the results of many other listed companies which have declared their results. While the demand in the premium real estate is relatively okay, mid and affordable segments demand has seen larger impact, and which is expected to last for one or two more quarters. This is also visible in town tier level sales, where we see degrowth in smaller towns. Unpredictable rains and erratic overall weather situation has also impacted consumer demand, especially for renovation. While we are already seeing offshoots of improving demand situation in quarter two, we expect the demand to revive from quarter three onwards. In Q1, we have managed to improve product mix of sales. This, along with lower input prices and a stringent focus on working capital management, enabled us to deliver a strong improvement in bottom line. We have seen a good improvement in our profitability and margins during the quarter. Our EBITDA reached Rs. 61 crores, marking a 27% increase and translating to an EBITDA margin of 16.47%. Our EBITDA margins improved 360 basis points year on year and experienced a notable improvement sequentially with 140 basis points as well. This improvement is largely owing to our efforts toward increasing the share of high margin products. We had also informed the market about our strategy of moving to produce larger, more premium sanitary wear products in-house, and I would like to inform the investors that we are on track for the same. The entire exercise will be completed by quarter three end. During the quarter, we reduced our working capital by 7 days over March 23, aligning with our 15-day commitment for the year. Moreover, we plan to direct our capital investments toward creating brand stores for market expansion and efficiency enhancement in existing manufacturing. These initiatives aim to elevate product ASPs and margins. For our bathware business, we have beaten the other listed entities in growth by a large margin and gained significant market share in the last 2 financial years. We are confident of continuing to gain our market share on the back of a well-crafted growth strategy that we have adopted. The first is to continue to launch innovative products across segments and categories. Secondly, we continue to build the brand Hindware. Thirdly, to consistently expand our distribution in reach as we believe there is significant opportunity in Tier 2, Tier 3 cities. Our fourth area of emphasis in strengthening premium and luxury category of products. All these efforts are underlined by our strong influencer programs for key stakeholders such as architects and plumbers, amongst others, and strong 360-degree integrated marketing campaigns for all our brands. We continue to retain our guidance of 1.25 to 1.5 times of the market growth rate for our revenue. We have given a guidance in 2021 and we've been achieving our guidance, and we believe we're on track in a mid to long term. I would now like to hand over the call to Mr. Rajesh Bajnu to take you all through plastic pipes and fittings business. Over to you, Rajesh.
Thank you, Sudhanshu. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this earnings call. TrueFlow, our brand for plastic pipes and fittings, aims to maintain its status as the fastest growing brand in its sector. In this quarter, the segment reported revenue of 156 crores, Q1 FY24. The revenue was impacted primarily due to a sluggish demand scenario coupled with reduced raw material prices. EBITDA reached at 10.4 crores with margins at 6.6%. While our volumes experienced an increase of 13% year-on-year during the quarter, lower PVC resin prices pulled down the same in value terms. Our PVC products exhibited improved performance while CPVC sales saw a marginal dip, contributing around 40% in value terms as compared to 47% last year. In Q1 FY24, we connected actively with plumbing consultants, plumbers, and organized multiple training sessions for our channel partners and influencers. We intend to maintain these efforts in subsequent quarters to reinforce our presence. Our commitment to expanding our distribution network remains steadfast with our 280 active distributors and around 25,000 retailers currently in our network. Despite these challenges, we remain committed to our goal of expanding our market share, and we are actively making efforts towards price realization and incentives to drive volume growth. Our unwavering dedication to enhancing brand awareness also remains a top priority, as we aim to fortify our position. Our foray into PTMT faucets and other accessories provides customers with a comprehensive solution for all their plumbing needs, and our exclusive collaboration with Reliance Worldwide Corporation, we introduced TrueFlow Shark Pipe, a revolutionary line of multi-layer composite pipes. These are NOR certified and hold a European patent for push-to-connect joining system. In line with our accelerated growth strategy, we continue diversifying into new regions. Our Roorkee Greenfield project is on track with operations expected to commence by Q3 FY25. Our performance instills assurance that we are making good progress towards exceeding the sales target of rupees 1,000 crores before the projected FY25 guideline. I would now like to hand over the call to Mr. Salil Kapoor to take you through consumer appliances and retail businesses. Over to you, Salil.
Thank you, Rajesh. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us for our Q1 FY24 earnings call. I'm excited to be a part of the Hindware Home Innovations team. I do believe the company has a lot of exciting opportunities, and we are in the process of charting a strong growth path. Our continuing endeavor will be towards consolidating and enhancing our portfolio with innovative and customer-centric offerings and supporting these initiatives with effective operations and supply chain and focused sales and marketing. Our quarterly performance is largely reflective of the challenges prevailing in the sector at present. Consumer demand, particularly in small towns and rural areas, was impacted on the back of inflation concerns. Our kitchen division, though, demonstrated strength on the back of our technically superior product portfolio and our focused multi-channel distribution strategy comprising both online and offline and of exclusive brand shops. For this business, we have both gained market share and improved on the margin front. The demand for our cooling products, however, saw a decline due to a delayed monsoon. Increased inventories compelled market players to offer discounts in order to stimulate sales. As inflation begins to taper and the festive season commences, we expect the demand environment to strengthen. We will continue to leverage our core strength of innovation and introducing technically superior products. We have now submitted applications for over 33 patents and will continue to build on that. Our unified commerce approach will continue to drive performance across channels, both online and offline. That concludes the opening remarks, and I would like to ask the moderator to open the floor for questions and answer session. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. First question is from the line of Udit Gajwala from Yes Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, team, and thank you for the opportunity. So, firstly, on the bathware side, if you see, then you stated that the peers have not reported growth, but when we look at your closest listed peer, they have reported growth on YOY basis, but we have reported a flattish number. Is it because we are losing market share, or is it because the metro is slow versus they are concentrated geography?
Yeah, so that's a fair question. And what I would like to say is that for the last two consecutive financial years, we've beaten the closest competitor in FY22 by 40% over 20% their growth, and last year on 29% over 22% their growth. So for 24 months, we've been gaining share on them. This is the first quarter phenomenon. I give a number of quarter-on-quarter growth as well. The decline for the closest competitor has been 19% over the previous quarter versus our decline on quarter-on-quarter at minus 11%. So what it clearly indicates is that we had a higher base in quarter one of last year. It's a technical point because last year we had a larger price increase which gave us some substantial gains in quarter one of FY23. And that's the key reason. I would really urge all the investors who look at market shares and trends on a slightly longer term basis. And, in my view, reacting to on a quarter on quarter basis on market share terms is, I would say, something which can be avoided.
See, most of our guidance is, you know, like we always add a caveat to our guidance whenever we give. We always say that don't measure us on a quarter to quarter basis. We have a strategy in place and we are walking our path. And if you see last 24 months, we have proved whatever we are doing. So markets at all times are not under our business control, you know, like markets. Some of the quarters do have, you know, upsets and downsides. So that's the point which we are trying to reiterate here and what Sudhanshu is trying to communicate.
Fair, sir. And so secondly, when we say it is 1.25 to 1.5x of market growth, do you have any, like for pipes, we have a target of 1,000 crore. Is there any ballpark number that you all are internally targeting by 25 for the bathware division?
See, we have maintained that we would grow by 1.25 to 1.5 times the growth is because, and we maintain that and not give a percentage term or an absolute number because we peg ourselves to market growth. Now, as we see, in this current quarter, the market growth has actually come down quite significantly. So, in my view, I think we should stick to the fact that we will beat the market by 1.25 to 1.5 times. I dare say the market, which was growing at 15% plus in the previous 2 years, has cooled off, and I believe it will be in big single digits. So by that logic, yeah, we should be growing in teens. But I would still refrain from giving you an exact number.
Okay. And so coming to the pipe business, have we, the other peers have reported volume growth in the north of 14-15x%. I understand that we are not a part of Jal Jeevan as much because we are more towards the plumbing end only. But on volume front, would you like to throw any guidance for 24 and what kind of EBITDA per kg are you expecting for full year?
See, we definitely are into the addressable market of plumbing and not the agricultural side. And since plumbing had a pressure and we still have grown by 12.5% of the volume, wherein the CPVC there is a decline and our last year our percentage of, which I already said in my opening remarks, percentage to sales was around 47%. This year it is just 50%. There is a pressure on plumbing. And we are looking forward that, and also the decline prices of PVC. We have increased our volume by 27% in PVC and declined around 12% in CPVC. But all said and done, we are hopeful that yes, an oversight of double digit this year, complete year, we'll be having our EBITDA.
EBITDA or margin, sir, is that?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, and so this last question from my end. So we are seeing a falling prices in CPVC as well. Was there any element of inventory loss this quarter? And is that also a reason where the dealers are not stocking inventory because they are anticipating falling prices?
We didn't have any inventory loss as far as CPVC is concerned.
Okay, and anything on the PVC market?
PVC is definitely, there was a little, because since we are not now carrying huge inventories in this industry, last one and a half years, people are not carrying inventory. So there was hardly any impact of, say, around approximately very less impact of inventory loss.
Okay. Thank you for answering, sir. I'll fall back in the queue.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Harsh from Chris PMS. Please go ahead.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes,
you're audible. Please go ahead.
So wanted to understand how are we on our initiative for adding new dealers for pipes, and what is the current revenue per dealer, and what is the dealer turnover which we are seeing? Is there any dealer who's leaving Hindwell? Specifically for the pipes division.
Yeah, we operate with something. See, this business is on a super distributor model. So we operate at the moment with around 280 distributors. And we have increased the distributors to the tune of 30 to 35 distributors in the first quarter. But the growth is not there because of the pressure on the sales. But we have built more people than the last quarter.
Okay. Okay, and are we seeing the revenue, so the revenue per dealer is flat, and are we seeing any dealers leaving or this is the net 30-35 dealers added?
Has come down. In fact, we have built more, 34 people more in this quarter, but the revenues have come down.
Okay.
There is a pressure on secondaries and the stocking of the product.
Okay. Thank you. That was the only question.
Thank you. A reminder to our participants, please press star and one to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Nikhil Gada from Abacus AMC. Please go ahead.
Hi sir. Thanks for the opportunity. Firstly, on the plastic pipes division, I just wanted a confirmation. You said the decline in CPVC was 1% and the growth in PVC was 27%, right?
Pardon? The growth in volumes of PVC was around 27% and almost around the same degrowth in volumes in CPVC, which amounts to around 12.7% of volume growth, overall volume growth, because you process more in PVC.
No, you mentioned CPVC decline is how much, sir? Sorry?
Almost around same decline, 27%.
Okay, because mathematically, I don't know whether it would work, because if we have...
tonnage-wise, you process more PVC.
Okay, I'll confirm that later. But coming to the reason, because when you say that, the housing demand has been weak, but when we see the growth that we have seen in PVC, is it fair to assume that because PVC has become more affordable, we are seeing, the consumer switching more to PVC, and hence we are also seeing this sort of a decline in CPVC?
No, precisely not. To a certain extent, yes, but the growth in PVC as reported throughout the industry is because the Q1 has been too good for agricultural market.
Mm-hmm.
So PVC contributes to agricultural market also, but that is not in our addressable segment.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want the people who may report some growth in, because Q1 is almost for a plumbing sort of an market, it is around, it constitutes around 17 to 18% of the total revenue, that is Q1. But when it comes to these are two different segments. When it comes to the agricultural segment, it's almost around 26 to 27% of the whole year. So people who are more into agricultural segment have definitely done well in this Q1.
Sir, but I am assuming that we are not selling any agri pipes. So basically for us, it really should not matter, right? Whether, how the agri demand pans out or does not. Especially if our major channel is going to be through housing, right?
We do manufacture agricultural pipes, but what happens is agricultural pipes these days are also used in the household applications. They are used in place of when it comes to a joining system, there is a pasting type of a joint. So people tend to use agricultural pipe than the SWR pipe. So which makes it little cheaper, the system gets cheaper. So people have used it, and I think we have sold in that segment. That's why our PVC growth is there.
So in that case, can you share, the agri versus housing mix for this particular quarter, and can you share it over year basis so we get a better understanding?
That's a very small component. I think, Nikhil, what Mr. Pajnu was trying to say is that when you see the results of various competitors, they are showing a PVC growth, and that PVC growth is primarily coming from agriculture segment rather than the plumbing segment. That's the point which Mr. Pajnu was trying to put forth.
Okay, sir. Fair enough. So just on the margins front for pipes, when we mentioned that we have not seen any major inventory loss, so, excuse me, is it fair to assume that the margin impact that we are seeing is purely because of mix?
The margin impact is basically nickel, because we are, the base is very small, since we are a very small player, we are just growing, we are in our fifth year of operation. So all our operational costs are there. And
I understand that. I am just trying to say, because fourth quarter as well, we have done, close to 10.5% sort of an EBITDA margin. And barring any inventory impact, because I assume that we would have still been closer to 8.5% or 9% sort of a levels. So I think the only reason could be mix, right?
No, it's like Q4 was a very high, it was the highest sales. So the industry does and we had also done. And Q1 we have just in 156 crores. So those operational things have only overheads which are fixed costs are there and then they have impacted this.
Okay, fair enough. And when you are guiding for a full year EBITDA margin of double digit, is what I heard, if I heard correctly. So from that perspective, you are expecting this mix that we are seeing in CPVC to improve, right, over the coming 9 months?
It should improve. It should improve, especially in Q3 and Q4. So on a year early basis, we can definitely aim to achieve double digit EBITDA on lower side.
Got it, sir. And sir, secondly, just coming on the sanitary ware and faucets part of the business. Firstly, just on the margins front, can we give a breakdown between sanitary ware and faucets for this particular quarter versus year over year, please?
Yeah, you want a ratio?
Yes, sir. Yes, ratio, please.
So faucets in this quarter is 35-36%.
And what would the same number be year over year, sir? Last year, same time?
Almost similar percentage.
Okay, so just on the overall EBITDA margin that we have seen an improvement even on a sequential basis. So is there any sort of a benefit in terms of any one-time benefit or is it some more product mix benefit, if you can, you know, sort of highlight it a bit in detail?
So, if you recall, Nikhil, you know, like we had a similar discussion while we were on a quarter three call or a quarter two call, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, at that particular time, there was a steep increase in the input prices. And we had communicated to the market that we are in the process of, you know, enhancing our selling prices, so, which has been done. But off late, what has happened is now, you know, there is a moderation on the input prices, and gas prices are also coming down.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a pure impact of that, plus the product mix, which is there. We have given a guidance for margin expansion, and we are holding on to that, I think, whatever it is. You know, we're given around 2%, which we said that we should do the expansion of margin in this particular next 18 months.
Mm-hmm.
So we are walking that path, and the abruptions in the market, especially on the steep increases in the input prices, has normalized on the market on the stable. But I think what is impacting is the high inflationary rates, higher interest rates, the EMIs have for the, you know, the respective consumer classes increased. So there has been some headwind on this business, on the building material business, on account of all these factors.
Mm-hmm.
We feel that, you know, it's a phenomena. And I think Q3 should be more over when the festival season comes. You know, like there is always a certain reaction to the market. And then, you know, when the festival season comes in, the mindset of the people, you know, they come into the spending mode. So it revives back. In the history, we have seen a number of quarters happening like this.
Mm-hmm.
And just to add, I think it's not only about what is the faucet contribution or the sanitary ware contribution. It's
mm-hmm.
either it's within the sanitary ware and within the faucet that's shifted to a more premium, and that's what I mentioned in my opening address. So.
Mm-hmm.
Within the sanitary ware and within the faucet ware has actually been better mix, you know, for us. We've been able to procure better. We've been, our food prices have come down. So this is, that's where the margins are actually.
Yeah, I think one point which you would like to highlight is, I think there are many people have seen us, our media sports which we have done with IPL. So that's why I think we can talk about that also.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. So your voice is not very clear.
Yeah, and Q1 we also had a major event on a major sponsorship of IPL which we had done, which I'm sure most of the investors would have seen. So that also was focusing on the more premium product. So we continue to focus on premium products, and that's been one of our key strategies in terms of improving our margins.
So, sir, then just on the, just to close out the EBITDA margin part, so do we see this sort of margin that we are seeing run rate improving further because we are also going to add, you know, higher margin products in-house? Or do you think this sort of a run rate sustains for FY24?
So I think this should sustain right now. Then, like, what we are trying to put forth is in Q1 there was a media spot, you know, and IPL is an event which happens in Q1, so we spent time there also. So, but there are some, again, you know, on the media spot there are, then Q2 is a little bit lean, but then Q3 again, you know, because all the festive season comes in, and then the media squad will also start. So there's an opportunity always to spend the margin here, but we are taking an optimal call here, spending very judiciously on the marketing, supply chain, product. Everywhere there are a number of initiatives which are being done, and on the back of it, we are very confident that, you know, like whatever growth numbers we are talking on a medium to long term range, and also the margin expansion which is known, which the guidance we have given, we should be able to do that.
Got it, sir. Just one last question from my side before I join back in the queue. I guess you mentioned that you are targeting a 50 days working capital commitment in the sanitary ware and faucets business. Did I hear it correctly?
15 days, not 50 days.
15 days. One five. We said we would improve our working capital by 15 days in this year, and we've already done that by 7 days in Q1. Is what I mentioned in my opening remarks.
So that basically goes to 90 days, 90 to 100 days.
Yes. I mean,
like we were at 112 days for our past business. Now we are at 105 days,
and we've basically been below. 100 days,
97-98 days
for the year.
Sir, is it also that we have tightened our working capital cycle a wee bit, also impacting our growth by any chance?
No, our DSOs are very similar to last year on our receivables. It's our inventory which is actually, you know, we've tried to control.
Okay. Got it, sir. I have few more questions. I'll join back in the queue.
We can finish that.
Okay, great, sir. So coming just, you know, on the consumer durables part of the business, and I understand that, you know, air cooler sales might have been lost because this being one of the major seasons. Just from the perspective of how we see this business, especially now in 24 as well as in 25, what kind of a growth can we target in this business, and is it going to be from the existing products, or do you think that some new products need to be introduced to basically scale this business up so that, you know, our fixed costs also get sort of used up and we get the operating leverage benefits?
So if you look at, we already have three strong pillars of growth, the products that we have already invested in past, both on the product portfolio front as well as the distribution front. The first one being, of course, kitchen segment, chimneys and other associated products around it. Mm-hmm. The second one being water heaters, where we have now a JV and our own production facility, which will improve not only the product per se, also you know, on the margin front. And third, of course, the air coolers, where we have a very strong digital presence, and we have both a large chunk of the online sales. Mm-hmm. Now, we will, you know, go further deep into these categories and build on that going forward. There are other segments also which are available. We have, you know, quite a few of them. We might want to reevaluate those and look at certain categories like air purifiers and heat convectors and others, which are highly seasonal and the sell-out window is too brief. So those we might want to reevaluate, but we'll certainly go deep and grow, you know, build further on the three large growth pillars that we have invested in already.
Understood. So any guidance for 24-25 that you would want to give at this point of time so that we get some clarity how to evaluate?
I think I'll take another quarter before I can give some guidance, and I will also get some more time to look at the opportunities that we can unlock. So let's wait for one or two quarters before we can actually come down on exactly the numbers and on the projections.
Sure, sir. And sir, just one last part from my end. If you could highlight our debt reduction plans. I think we were mentioning somewhere around 100 crores for FY24. If you can also give some numbers for 25 as well, how do we see the net debt numbers going? Because we are still seeing an increase in the net debt tables if we see from quarter-on-quarter basis.
So, Nikhil, we had stated that with the given capex of odd ranging from 140 to 150 crores in this financial year, we should be able to clear off our debt by around 100 crores. Next year, we have some spending again on the pipe plant, which is, which is under, set up at Roorkee. So that plant cost is 180 crores. This year we spent all 60, 70 crores on the project, and that will be spent next year. So we'll take another figure of another 100 crores repayment next year. We are very gung-ho on our businesses, like pipe business. So, we see that there's a good potential in this business. That's why we want to do this project much faster now, actually.
So is it fair to assume that our net debt still would be in the range of 650 to 700 odd crores by FY25 as well?
How much is the figure you have on 23?
23 was, I think, somewhere around 720 crores, if I'm not wrong.
So 720 minus 100 and another minus 100.
But we are also doing the capex, so that was the reason I was asking.
But we are earning profits also.
So then basically we are just have to say that 200 crores deduction would happen in the net debt.
That's the plan, actually, as on date.
Got it, sir. Fair enough. Thank you and all the best. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Yash from Steinberg. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. I have one broad question, one more specific question. One broader question, since Hindware is obviously operating in the whole real estate space, the real estate market actually is doing quite well, at least as per my channel checks. Why is it that our revenue growth has been sluggish in an environment where, let's say, the industry growth has been pretty strong?
Yeah, so as I mentioned in my opening address, the real estate market is basically growing very well, relatively well in the premium segment. However, mid and affordable segments are basically under stress. And if you want, I can quote some numbers. The affordable part of the segment actually degrew by 21% in the last 6 months. As per reported numbers, while mid-segment, I don't have exact numbers for that. Affordable is defined as a segment because government decides the selling price of the affordable segment. So it's a very well-defined segment. So that new launches degrew by about 20%. So what we're saying is real estate market is actually seeing action only in the premium segment in the metros, but not at an overall level. So that's what our
understood. And one question on the margin side, where let's say after the Q4 results, there was a guidance of about low teens margin for the full year. I want to understand, let's say that it's been about a year since we have taken the manufacturing in-house, where initially, the margins didn't reflect because raw material prices were high. In this quarter, we've seen the raw material prices compress quite significantly with almost a 4 percentage points impact improvement quarter on quarter. I'm just surprised, where is the balance margin going? And in terms of, ideally, the thought process was that on the year before, let's say there was a before the manufacturing was in, we were at the 8-9% margin range. The thought process was that when manufacturing would come in, we will see about a 400 bps improvement in that margin. It just seems that that has not played out in the current quarter, despite the improvement in raw material prices.
So typically, if you see, how much is the number you have for bathware business of Q4 FY23?
Q4 FY23, I have 15.3% EBITDA margin.
Sorry, my apologies. FY22.
FY22, I have about 11.5%.
Now it's 16.7.
Okay. Correct.
So the mathematics which we are trying to do is basically what you have to see here is we gave a guidance, whatever, like if you see till 31st March 2022, we were buying from our other group company on a cost plus basis, you know. And even in those periods, we were buying at an EBIT margin markup for, you know, our basket business around 4.5% EBIT margin level. So whatever the cost was being incurred there, 4.5% at EBIT level cost was being passed on. Now, since there is no factory there, there is no cost other than the rentals which are there for the factory. Because there are two parcels of land and building which we did not do because of the, you know, very high cycle rates and high stamp duty impact. So rest entire margin flow is already happening into the business. So your apprehension where the margins are going is margins can't go anywhere. There is no other factory now other than there.
Understood. No, fair. I'm saying that it could also be because of negative operating, like adverse operating leverage. The idea was to understand that we've seen 5 quarters of the transition play out. So,
5 quarters have not been the natural quarters because if you just benchmark the input prices over the last 24 months, you will have all those answers with you. You know, the gas prices from 18 rupees to 60 rupees, right now at 40 bucks, 40, 45 rupees. Input zinc prices, brass prices, everything moved up. And on the CPVC prices, again, you know, it had a big swing on either side. So the point, I think, which I've been trying to reiterate is that we bought those factories. Now it's a consolidated operation, a focused company. So there are no other, you know, substantial related party transactions as it was happening before. Whatever the factory margins were, they are now being a part of Hindware only. It's not that we have started, you know, producing inefficiently now. Still producing very efficiently. So whatever the margins are there, there's a combo of, you know, it's not an apple-to-apple comparison right now. That's very difficult to maintain.
So would it be fair, sir, to say that this margin, let's say suppression of margins at some level is partly because of the fact that 2-3 businesses are operating at suboptimal margins, which is the pipes and consumer business at this point, and even the retail business?
So pipes will not say it's a suboptimal because, to be very frank, you know, we just don't make any commitment on a guidance on a quarter because if you see consistently, like when we did our results last year, we have been disclosing how much is our inventory loss. So if you add the inventory losses, which the entire industry suffered actually, then we done very transparently that, you know, the PVC and resin prices moved from 160 rupees to almost 75-80 rupees. So whatever the inventory loss anybody is holding in this industry, the entire pass-on is a pass-on, you know, to the end consumer. So if you add, you will see that there is a consistency in the margin which is happening. We are making a consistent gross margin in the business. You know, we are making, but this, again, this is again a mathematical tweak. In a sense, you know, like sometimes the rate goes up, sometimes, you know, some other factors are playing. But what you have to see is on the perspective of the gross margin, we have been able to maintain our gross margins in our business. In fact, we have been expanding that, you know, over the last few years.
Understood. And so given that all the segments are operating at different numbers, and as you also mentioned, what's happening is the multiple moving parts are resulting into, let's say, the current reported margin being similar to what it was earlier. I just thought it would be possible for you, sir, to kind of give, let's say, on a steady state basis, assuming normalization, what would be the kind of segmental margins that we should expect? And if that's possible, so that would be very helpful.
I think we can look at it, but I don't confirm right now. Because then we have to create a segmental margin correlation over the last, you know, so many years. And the market has been volatile. We had COVID events in between. So we'll try to do that. It's a good question. We'll try to work on it.
Understood. And sir, one question. The 16.7% margin that you mentioned, is that after allocation of corporate costs? Oh, that's before allocation of corporate cost, right?
Yes.
So, sir, sorry to kind of just double click on this, but essentially, historically, in the previous avatar, which is, let's say, HSIL, and for 5, 6, 7 years, we actually did more than 20% margins or near about 20% EBITDA margins in this segment. So do we see our margins for the bathware segment, which is basically X pipes and fittings, going to 20% plus?
I can't think if you see in the history, we have been doing ranging 19 to 21% margins on sanitary wear. But predominantly, during that time, we were primarily the sanitary wear, you know, business. Our faucet businesses during that time was ranging 200 to 150 crores. But the sort of margins, percentage margins, which we have in sanitary wear is still high. But what happens is, as the faucet business is also growing, it gets averaged out. You know, that I, to be very clear, you know, we don't make 20% plus EBITDA margin on faucets. So it's a mix of the bucket. So as the businesses and the growth on the faucet size and the market size is much bigger. So as the growth of the faucets increases, absolute EBITDA will increase, but the percentage margins will decrease because the input factor in sanitary wear is a clay, but input factor in faucets is brass. Much costly material, so you have a numerator and a denominator effect coming here.
Understood. And sir, if with your permission, I'd just like to ask one more question. On the retail business, so what is the thought process here? Because it doesn't fit perfectly within our scheme of things. So just thought maybe I could ask you about that.
So we have spoken about this business. As on date, the status remains the same. We are looking at various alternates. What should we do with this business? Definitely, I understand what your question is. I can only sum up saying, you know, we are evaluating various options on this business right now.
Thank you. Yes, may I request you to join the queue for any follow-ups, as there are several participants waiting for their turn. Also, before we take the next question, we'd like to remind our participants to limit their question to two per participant. If time permits, you may join the queue for any follow-ups. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Ghosh from DSP. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. I have three questions. If you, in your bathware business update, your net working capital days has come down by about 7, which I think Sudhanshu also mentioned in the call. But your net borrowing has increased. Is it on account of higher capex, or what is it that related to?
Abhishek, Naveen this side. We have, this Hindware has given the dividend to the Hindware Home Innovation. So that is why this around 29 crore got added.
Sorry, could you repeat that again, sir?
So basically, when you compare the borrowing as on 31st March 2023 versus 30th June, so there was a dividend of odd 29-30 crores which has been paid by Hindware to the parent company. You know, as a result of which, you know, one time the borrowing increases as such.
So this should not impact our consolidated level debt from net debt from that perspective.
Yes, technically so, because the money will move from bottom to the top.
So on a bathware segment basis, the debt has gone up, but on a consolidated level, the debt should have come down because the working capital has also come down and plus. So how should we look at it in that light?
Yeah, mathematically yes.
So on a consolidated level, has the net debt remained stable? Q on Q.
It has come down from 113 crores for the consumer business to 95 crores. So it has reduced here by around 18 crores.
Yes. Sorry, your voice is not very clear, sir.
So for the consumer business, if you see the slide 25 for our presentation, so it has reduced from 113 crores to 95 crores.
Okay. And the same thing is with, if you look at the pipe division as well, Rajesh, we had seen a good working capital reduction in 4Q. Again, the net working capital days has increased. Any thoughts on the same? And what is a stable net working capital days that one should probably look at?
Sorry, Abhishek, we request you to please remain connected. It seems we have lost line for the management.
Sure.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we have the management line reconnected. Sir, over to you. Abhishek, may I request you to repeat your question, please?
Thanks. So in the plastic pipe division, we have seen a net working capital seeing an increase on a Q-on-Q basis from about 62 to 92 days. So what's a stable net working capital days that one should work with in the pipes part of the business?
Number of days. net working capital number of days should be ranging around 80 to 90,
75 to 80, 90. Sir, should range between 80 and 90, is it?
Yeah.
So last quarter was an aberration.
Yes, because it's very difficult. You know, when the sales are down, everything goes for a spin.
Fair, fair. Okay. And just in terms of your retail business, we have seen about a 3.5 crores kind of an EBIT loss in the current quarter. Any thoughts, because that's a segment that was barely breaking even. So any thoughts in terms of going forward, while you've spoken about briefly in terms of evaluating the business, but in terms of losses, is there any exercise being done to kind of control the losses there?
If you see, you know, like I talk about the strength of the businesses, you know, like this business used to do 100 crores odd business while we were in the retail model. Very good brand, Evoke brand. The recall of people on the Evoke brand is very high because we had a pan-India presence. Now the business models over the last 4 or 5 years have changed. A lot of searches are happening on online portals. And again, the competition there is also, you know, being increased every day. Like we had dedicated online furniture businesses. They are going from online to offline. Then there are other Amazons and other who are also selling furniture. So in the interim, we shut down around 3 years back. We shut down our retail business and we moved on to the primarily franchise business, plus the online business which is there. So we are evaluating what we can do with this business. We understand this is not the core business on which we should attack. But we have to understand and evaluate various options before, you know, we take a decision. I think another 3 to 6 months, we may do something with it.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before we take the next participants, we'd like to remind the participant, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants, please limit your question to one per participant. The next question is from the line of Darshil Javeri from Crown Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello. Good evening, sir. Thank you so much for taking my question. Sir, from what I understand, so maybe our a major segment some pressure in the next 1-2 quarters, but we might see strength coming back. So overall, on a broad basis, in maybe FY25, could we achieve better growth? And when can we see our consolidated margins, you know, maybe going to 11-12%? And I also just wanted to ask about the level of tax that we had this quarter was a bit higher. So, you know, could we help some reconciliation in that?
So your voice was not clear to us. I think the question which you had was...
Hello. Sorry. Am I audible, sir?
You are audible, but your voice, I think you are holding your microphone too near to your mouth.
Sorry. Is this better, sir?
Now it is much better. So I think what I could understand is, one question is on the margin expansion and second is on the tax. Am I right?
Yeah, correct, sir.
So I'll request Sudhanshu to talk broadly and on the margins, you know, what number of initiatives which we are doing internally on the product mix, you know, putting material inside. And on the tech side, I think, I don't know whether you read the note to the accounts 2B and 2A. So there was a dividend, you know, as we told, you know, being paid by Hindware to the parent company. And as a part of the consolidation, what happens is the dividend gets knocked off because it's a relationship between the parent and the subsidiary, but the tax on the dividend is provided. So what happens is on a standalone basis you will find the rationality of the tax rate, but on the consolidated basis you will not see that rationality because dividend gets knocked off amongst the parent and the subsidiary. In terms of margin, Sudhanshu, we can talk about a few initiatives which we can talk.
Yeah, so margin, I think, I think I mentioned in the previous question as well, one of the key initiatives which we're doing is, which we talked in the last investor call as well, is that we are planning to reduce our import dependence and increase domestic procurement of both our sanitary ware and largely sanitary ware. And we are well on course for this transition. There is a transition which is happening in our manufacturing plant, which I mentioned in my opening remarks, is going to get concluded by end of Q3. We've also developed extremely strong suppliers within domestic markets. So we believe from a number of about 16-17% of import dependence on FY23, you know, FY25 should be, you know, a mid or low single digit number in terms of percentage contribution. And that will be a massive, you know, impact on our profitability. Can't really give you a number here, but that, you know, these are all initiatives we'll add on to the committed numbers in terms of margin expansion. Additionally, like I said, we are focusing a, you know, a lot on premium products, you know, dependence on Odisha fans and basically the WCs is now converting into one pieces and wall mounts. And similarly, for example, in faucets to, you know, premium diverter-based faucet products. So that's something which is expanding, you know, definitely will give us margin expansion. We are also, you know, working a lot in terms of, you know, in terms of reducing our cost. There are lots of DT design to value initiatives which are happening within the organization in terms of lightweighting of products, in terms of looking at re-engineering the products to make sure that the products are, you know, basically satisfying the needs of the consumer and are not over-designed. And then that really adds a lot of value in terms of expansion margins. So all these things, you know, which is really helping us in terms of increasing our margin at an overall level to be delivered.
Thank you, Mr. Javeri. Request you to join the queue for any follow-ups. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Ghosh from DSP. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity again. A couple of questions. One is on the bathware side of the business. Has there been any price hikes which has been taken in first half and outlook for the second half?
So we have not taken any price hike in quarter one and even not yet in quarter two as well. So no price hike. You know, as we discussed, the input prices have stabilized for most of the product categories. So at this point in time, I don't see any price hikes happening within the business in the second half of the year as well.
Okay. And sir, in terms of raw material index, is it kind of stable now or is it still kind of declining?
So I would say it's pretty stable. I would go with, you know, with the government guidance there where they have kind of actually increased the inflation forecast for the year from 5.1% to 5.4%. I would say even material index is at this point is stable. I don't see further declines happening. I can say that about the bathware part of the business. For the pipes business, I would request Mr. Pashmi.
So I was asked, so my concern was more around the bathware only. On the
bathware, I do not see too much of you know, drastic reduction. Of course, there can be a natural variation which happens in commodity pricing, but I don't see any drastic change in pricing happening at this point in time.
And the benefits of lower fuel prices has already flown through to the P&L?
It is a, you know, at some part, yes, it is definitely flowing into our P&L. That's what we had.
So the inventory which was made with a high-cost material, you know, once it gets sold. So it's a process over a period of time.
Yeah.
But the first sort of symptoms of margin expansion are already visible there.
Okay, great. Just on the, you know, pipes part of it, since you have a large exposure of CPVC with respect to peers, any thoughts in terms of growth from here on? Because there's a lot of growth which are coming in from agri and other things. So in that context, how should we look at your growth for next 12 to 15 months? And what are the peak volumes that you can do over the next 12 to 24 months given your capacities?
See, this is probably, I think, after 18 quarters that we have been giving growth over growth. from the time we launched. Now it is for the first time, and we are also seeing a decline in CPVC last 3 years, probably after 3 years. So we don't see any reason that it should not grow, but maybe, you know, timely there is all around the world the demand for housing has come down a little bit, and because of all this China effect. But we definitely see in from Q3 onward, there will be a growth in this segment, and we stick to our aspiration of 1,000 crores FY25.
Okay. And in terms of your, given wherever your capacity is, what is the peak volumes that you can do in, sir, over the next 12 to 15 months?
We have a capacity of 44,000 metric tons as of today, which we are scaling up slowly. At last year, we had a capacity utilization of highest in the whole industry. We almost utilized, we had a 90% capacity utilization. This year, it's almost around, because the average of the industry is 65 to 70%. We are at around 78% of capacity utilization.
So you mentioned your current capacity is 44,000 tons, right?
48,000 metric tons.
48. And what should it look like over the next 12 to 15 months?
So we have an additional interest in around 18 months. We should get another 12,500 tons of Roorkee, investment capacity, which we can further scale down in another 12 months to, whenever required, whenever the board approves it, to 25,000 by installing additional machinery. So, certain building and other infrastructure is being created essentially for the entire capacity. But the machines will come in piecemeal.
But the work for the Roorkee plant has already started.
Yes.
Okay, so within 18 months, we should see that. Okay, got it. Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Wish you all the best. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants are requested to limit their questions to two per participant. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Chandresh Malpani from Niveshaay Investment Advisors. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, Chandresh, please go ahead. We can hear you.
Yeah, so my question is on the PVC pipes. So if you can brief me about the, what ideal would be the volume mix on a yearly basis between CPVC and PVC? What are we targeting?
Our product mix, as I said earlier in my remarks and in other questions also, we are basically a plumbing category company. So our motto was, right from day one, to gain a market share in CPVC, which we did till last year. We had in our product mix, we had around 47% of CPVC share. But unfortunately, in Q1, because of this pricing and the housing demand, this has come down to around 40%. What we have sold in Q1, 40% contributes to CPVC. So we aim that the day we are at 50% of the market, total market of our product market, then we are among the top player in CPVC. That is what is our aim, and we presume that from third and fourth quarter, this should happen.
Okay. And sir, secondly, on the advertising and promotion expense, what is the budgeted number for this year, if you can test as a on-console?
Your voice is muffled. Please hold the mic a little bit away from your mouth, please.
Hello? Now it's better?
Could you use the handset, please? Yes.
Yeah, so my question is on the advertising and promotion and expense. What is the budgeted number for this year?
Which business you are talking about?
On console, or if you mostly on sanitary ware, bath, building products business.
On a console, on a console annual basis. Please remember this word, annual basis. We try to allocate on a consolidated basis around 3.5-4% of our sales towards building the brand. But this will include many activities like Sudhanju spoke about IPL. So IPL happens only in, it's a big buster of, media expansion opportunity. So that we do in Q1. But then you will see Q2 maybe a little bit lean, but then Q3 again picking up. So, but I'm giving a figure on the annualized annual basis, which is around 3.5-4% funds allocated for the marketing activities.
Thank you. Mr. Malpani, request you to join the queue for any follow-ups. The next question is from the line of Udit Gajiwala from Yes Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the follow-up, sir. Are there any capacity expansions that we are taking place for a sanitary faucet? You mentioned multiple times we are doing some improvement for the sanitary thing. So how much should that boost the capacity? And second, what was the outsource mix for sanitary faucet for the quarter?
We couldn't understand your first question. Your voice is not clear. That is the second question. What is the first question?
Are we doing any capacity expansions in a sanitary faucet plant?
Oh, we are not doing sanitary expansion in this. But Sudhanshu, if you go through the transcript of the last call, we had given a complete guidance that we are moving single pieces inside the factory and moving, you know, the low-end product outside. That's a part of the strategy which we are, you know, doing step by step. And this, Mr. Sudhanshu has already given guidance that this should be complete by the end of the quarter three of this financial year. Second question was on the mix of outsource to
on
the bank. The ratio is 70-30.
I'm sorry if I missed your voice.
It's about 70% insourced for sanitary ware and about 45-46% insourced for faucets.
Great. Thank you, Anand.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rasmik Oza from Nine Rays Equi Research. Please go ahead.
Sir, I have some observation and some suggestion. Since our business has now become very asset heavy, you know, and I know that the promoters own 51% in the company, still at today's market cap of 4,000 crore, if we can dilute 10% equity, we can raise 400 crore and straight repay debt. So even if you consider post-tax, you know, it could almost, and even if you take 10% dilution, it could almost enhance your EPS by 40% or so. Just wanted to bring this, you know, to the management, if you can actually try, and because this will improve your debt equity also, and it could lead to a lot of, you know, accretion to the shareholder value also going forward.
Basically, if you see, you know, like, I take your question, I appreciate your question, but you know, from the financial fundamental perspective, each growing company should be optimally leveraged. With a debt on a controlled level and with much bigger growth path, we feel that we are optimally leveraged right now. And we may look at diluting equity at the right stage at the right time. But I think proposing to the board of directors that I'll raise equity to pay off, 8% debt, I think the cost of equity is much higher as compared to the cost of debt. Plus, post-tax cost, if you see, we are, you know, 25% tax-paying company. So if you're getting funds at 6%, you know, and the post-tax equity cost is a market expectation which you, each one of you would like to have. So I think we'll work on the rationality of an optimal debt rather than having a debt-free company. We had also spoken about this, you know, in the last call. I would request that if you can refer there also.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Rasmik, is the question answered?
Yeah, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vedic from Monarch Network. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. My question would be, can you give us an outlook on the future growth performance for next 2 years on a blended basis? Currently, we saw a decline in the quarter, but as you believe that from Q3 onwards, the demand should revive back. So on a blended basis, what kind of growth you are expecting for the current year and for the next year?
So we will hold on to our guidance, you know, like which we gave on our bathware business and the pipes business way back 2 years, you know, and we have been holding on and we have performed as per those guidance. We are internally not bogged down by a quarter of a performance. We are walking a path and we are walking a strategy. We are still holding on to that. So only leeway is that we have given a guidance on the consumer business, which we feel that we may miss it by 12 to 18 months. And that guidance was, you know, on a consumer business will be 1,100 crores plus by 2025. But based on our performance over the last, you know, 12 to 18 months, that the market conditions there is on that particular business, on the consumer side, we feel that we may miss it by 12 to 18 months. but rest of the guidances are intact. So if you see our performance, we gave guidance on margin expansion on the pathway, which is very visible by businesses. Ultimately, if you see in the last 4 years has been growing, that has been the real gem of our investment, which the company has done in terms of building, you know, the growth into the company. By spending out 300 crores, we have, you know, generated around 800 crores of sales, which creates a lot of intrinsic value. Similarly, on our consumer business, we have been talking about a very tough business, but we have been very successful. Three-pillar story, which Salil has already spoken about, that we have made distinctions, you know, in our business on kitchen chimneys, woods and hobs. And secondly, also market. I'm not say a market very strong position, but a high growth position, both on the water heating segment as well as the air cooler segment. So there is a good amount of growth story which we are there, and we are really hungry for all the growth which is there. And we'll continue to invest our time, energy, resources in building a very strong business over a period of time.
Okay, sir. And so my final question would be for Salil, sir. What steps are we looking at, and what would be the key focus area for the company?
Sorry, I couldn't understand your question.
What steps are you looking at, and what would be the key focus area for you?
So basically, you know, I just spoke about it. You know, each of the business is a special focus area for us. It's not that we are looking at a one business and a one company. So we have three core businesses, which is our bathware business, pipes business, as well as our consumer business. Each one of us has a dedicated, you know, lead, which is run by very experienced CEOs. And we are there to grow in each one of them. We have given those guidances historically number of times, and we are walking that path, and we are very, very sure, based on the current market conditions, that we'll achieve those targets within those times. Other than the consumer, which, you know, I've already spoken about.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Chirag Filoke from Ratnatar Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon. Thank you so much for the opportunity. My first question is, could you just guide us for what is the gross
Chirag,
and the net
debt? May I request you to use the handset, please? Your voice is slightly muffled.
I hope this is better.
Yes.
Sorry, my first question is, just could you guide us on the gross and the net debt number for the quarter? What was the number for this quarter?
For the June, maybe we have that figure. The net debt is at, on a consolidated basis, it is 843 crores. I'm sorry, 790 crores.
790 crores this is net debt.
Yep.
Understood. Just another question, just a minor bookkeeping question on the segmental information that is available on slide 25 for the consumer appliances business. Broadly, the consumer appliances business seems like it's paying around 4.5 crores of interest. That's the difference between EBIT and PBT that's reported per quarter on a debt net borrowing of around 100 crores average and 110 crores. Which seems like more than 12-13%. Is that right, or is that just some accounting, that is happening here?
So there are some accounting matters into this. So basically, in consumer business, since we don't own any factories, we don't have any warehouses of our own, and all of them are outsourced. So all the warehouse rentals, since the contracts are of a long-term nature, so the entire rental, as per the accounting standard, gets allocated to depreciation and interest, which increases.
Understood. That's the right of use, sort of. That is the, is that the accounting that is happening there? Lease liability accounting. That is making the, understood. That's helpful. My only other question is just on the consumer appliances business, and you've partially answered that into one of the earlier participants. If you broadly look at last 6-7 quarters, right, I understand that the 1,000 crore guidance you might miss, but even just nominally, it looks like we are in the 120-130 crore range for the last 6-7 quarters. Maybe even if you go beyond, even if you go to December 2020, without water heaters, we were probably at that same number. Just wanted a little bit more color. Is there something where sort of you guys feel that this has hit a little bit of a ceiling and a couple of new products will take us to the next notch? Or is it something that you're not worried about? Just wanted color on that. Last 6-7 quarters have been around 120, 130 or so.
I will answer your question very candidly here. You know, like this was a new business which we launched around 7 years back. We had a full plethora of, you know, product portfolio. But what we have seen of late is that out of the whole gamut of the product portfolio, few of the product portfolio need some rationalization and some review. We are looking at a newer focus, wherein the potential is good, the brand acceptance is very high. We have worked on innovation and technology, and we have spoken about it. You can visit our website. We are the leaders in, you know, creating one of the few smart appliances for the first time in India. Only thing is, here, you know, we expanded the canvas. We have to shrink the canvas, and that should lead to a much higher growth. That should lead to much higher focus growth in terms of the segments which we have spoken about, which is kitchen chimneys, food and ops, and other kitchen equipments, and also our water heater as well as the air cooler business.
Understood. And you expect to do that rationalization over the next couple of quarters, is that correct?
Yes, Salil spoke about it, and he has requested the market to give him some time to get back because he's just joined around 30 days back.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that would be our last question for today. I now hand the conference back to the management for their closing comments. Thank you, and over to you.
Thanks, everybody, for joining on the call today. I know few of you would not have liked the numbers which had come on the quarter. But I think, again, my request is all we are walking a path, we are walking a strategy, and we are confident that the momentum which we have built on a medium to long-term range, we should be able to carry on that momentum, you know, as per the plans. Thank you very much. If you have any further questions, we are always happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Monarch Networth Capital, that concludes this conference. Thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.